Hi again. In the chapter Social Impetus of Primitive Christianity, Christianity and the Social Crisis by Walter Rauschenbusch, page 123, the new subhead is The Primitive Churches as Fraternal Communities. The disciples at Jerusalem had met in their homes and had eaten in common. The one act which might be called an act of distinctively Christian ritual at the beginning, the reminder of the Lord's last meal with his disciples, was performed in connection with these common meals, and this ensured the homeliness and simplicity of the rite. These common meals were so essential a part of the earliest church life that this custom was established wherever Christianity came. This in itself is a strong proof that the churches were more than organizations for worship. We know from Paul's letter to the Corinthians that the Christians met in the evening, the time for the chief meal of the day, and dined together. Such common meals were frequent in the Greek fraternal associations, and Greeks could easily fall in with the custom. These love feasts did not consist of eating a wafer as a religious symbol, as is done in some modern churches. It was a downright meal to which people became hungry, so that Paul advised them to get a bite at home to take the edge off their appetites if they were too hungry to wait for one another. And this is all based on the account 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 to 34. Now the assurance of one square meal means a great deal to a poor man physically. It means still more to his consciousness of human worth and his enjoyment of human intercourse to sit at a social function as the equal of all. To break bread in common brings men close to one another. At Corinth, the social differences had obtruded themselves at the common meals. The well-to-do had drifted together in a coterie. They had clubbed their well-fed baskets and were in danger of getting hilarious together, while the poor brother sat on one side, hungry and outside the pale of social enjoyment. Paul took this very seriously. It seemed to him a denial of the fundamental spirit of the churches. These common meals persisted for centuries, though changed in character. The ritual act of the Lord's Supper became more ceremonial, mysterious, and awe-inspiring, and a meal where people were heartily satisfying their physical hunger did not seem the fit environment for the mystery of the Eucharist. Hence, that part was transferred to the morning service. But the evening meal continued. As wealthy men entered the churches, they often defrayed the expenses of a meal and made it an act of charity to the poor. The rich paid and the poor ate. That was a complete departure from the democracy of the common meal at the beginning. But the persistence of the custom, even when all the conditions had so completely changed, proves how deeply it was embedded in the traditions coming down from the origin of Christianity. The provisions for the common meal were brought by each family, as in our basket picnics. When the Lord's Supper was transferred to the Sunday morning service, it still remained customary for the people to bring provisions along, and the material for the Eucharist was taken from these offerings. What was left was distributed to all who were in need. As time went on, regular monthly offerings of money were introduced, and under the ascetic enthusiasm of almsgiving, large properties were often turned over to the churches. It is significant that for a long time, the churches did not accumulate property. If real estate was given, it was sold, and the proceeds used up. If there was any special need, a collection had to be taken to meet it. In the Greek fraternal associations, the accumulation of income-bearing property was essential. The later church, too, derived its chief income from landed wealth. The primitive church, on principle, was without property. Moreover, the income of the church was wholly for those in need. In modern church life, the bulk of the income goes for the support of the clergy and the expenses of worship. And even of the expenses for benevolence, only a small fraction is for charitable help of the needy. In the primitive church, the officers were not paid unless they temporarily went without earnings to serve the church. In that case, they were supported because they were needy and not because they were officers. As the church was ecclesiasticized and clericalized, an increasing clergy was needed to do what the people at first had done for themselves. The clergy became a separate and priestly class for whom secular employment was not fitting and who had to be maintained. An ever-increasing proportion of the income of the church was devoted to the clergy and the expenses of the ritual. In the 5th century, it was regarded as a fitting division that one-fourth go to the bishop, one-fourth to the clergy, one-fourth for the maintenance of worship, and only one-fourth to the poor. Yet, in theory, the property of the church long remained the patrimony of the poor. This, too, was a survival of earlier traditions. We're linking to a series of videos we shot on Rodney Stark's book, The Rise of Christianity, specifically the chapter where he deals with how the church of the second and third centuries met the pandemics of the day and the contrast with the way the Romans and even their religion met those same emergencies.